Sirius Minerals is a diversified development company, potash development company. It has a key asset which it's developing in the highly prospective North York Moors National Park. A Sirius chief executive is Chris Fraser, who joins us now. Chris, welcome.
Thank you.
Those that know the project will know that Sirius, I think, has 1.3 billion tonnes, I think, of potash. Put this into some sort of context in terms of other potash mines.
It's difficult to put it in context with other potash deposits, because when potash occurs, generally it occurs in large volumes because they're ancient oceans effectively that have been evaporated. But 1.35 billion tonnes, which is just from 2% of our project area, to do 50 years of operation based on what we've articulated in our scoping study would be around 600 odd million tonnes of mineral would you need to make reach those production targets. So, to give you a context of 1.35 billion, it's very significant, and those production levels would be, you know, a top five potash mine in the world.
And what sort of waste do you have when you end up with what you mined?
That's the unique thing about polyhalite, is it has three components that are effectively all valuable products. There's only a small fraction in the higher grades that we've found in our ore body so far that is salt or anhydrite, which is calcium sulfate, which can be made into gypsum. But the majority of our product, when you process it through to SOP or sulfate of potash, the other products that come out of it are valuable products. Magnesium sulfate, which is a fertilizer product as well, and then gypsum for the building materials industry. It makes it very unique in the fact that nearly all of what you mine is a product of value, as opposed to traditional potash, which is generally around 70% waste.
My understanding from reading around is that you want to take it through to production. What are the costs going to be on that? I know production is not going to be immediate, but what sort of costs are you going to be facing?
All we've released so far is a scoping study, which was an early estimate of what's possible around the development. So in that, we had a phase one capital cost of $2.7 billion, which would take us to 1.4 million tonnes per annum of sulphate of potash and all the associated products. And then from there, we would then be generating significant cash flows to then fund a gradual expansion into what we call phase two, but it's a very modular approach to the development. We're looking at all sorts of options now, obviously now how we take that forward into feasibility studies in terms of whether we can reduce that, whether it's a different configuration or what.
Making it a modular project presumably helps, I suppose, when looking at funding these things.
Yeah, the process of processing the polyhalite into SOP was designed by our process engineers as a modular basis. So 1 million tonne per annum of ore is your module, and therefore you can essentially just continue to add modules as you expand the mine.
Now, you've had some placements, I know, which has brought some money onto the balance sheet. Where are you with cash, and how much more are you, when are you going to need to start raising more?
So we raised £55 million in January this year at 18p. That funding was to take us through the completion of exploration, feasibility studies, and get our approval in place. So we're well funded to get all that done. We're working on a timeline now to have our approval in place by the end of March, April next year, which is what we've set ourselves as our goal, and that we're doing everything we can to work in behind that with a feasibility study so that the project is construction ready at that point.
What sort of earnings will the mine generate? Have you got any idea?
Again, the scoping study numbers are the only ones, which is shows based on the assumptions we had in there of the prices of potash and the byproducts would generate around $600 million of EBITDA for phase one, and then that would expand almost to three times that once we completed building out to what's possible in phase two.
As I said at the top, you are in the North York Moors National Park, and I know that you want to submit, I think, a full planning application, don't you, by the end of this year?
That's right.
What's the difficulty surrounding that? I mean, the national parks are known for their protective attitude to any sort of building, let alone mines. How are you getting around that? What sort of relationship do you have with the national park?
Well, the national park's been incredibly professional since the very day that we announced this project. I'm sure it was a shock to them when we did announce it. But what we have done is been very considered and planned in our approach about how we take the project forward and engage with the community. So we've took a decision very beginning that we would build a very big support base in the local community first before really trying to make a big national story about what this mine could do, because obviously it is a huge potential employer and value creator for the UK and for the government in terms of tax revenues. So we work very closely with the community, and we always had a view that the mine was most likely to end up within the national park boundaries. Mm. We've done all the technical work to confirm that that's where it is going to be now. And as a result of that, we've done all the work we can in and around minimising as much impact as we can to reduce the risk of not getting the approval in place. To get the approval in the national park, you have to satisfy what's called the major development test, which is basically showing that there's a national need for the project, and that can be defined in many ways, that it can't. There's no scope for it outside the park, and we can show that that's the case technically. And then the last point is that if there's any environmental mitigants that are needed, that they're satisfactory to compensate for any impact. We released our minehead location last week, and that shows an incredibly small footprint within the national park. We made the decision to move the processing out of the park and move it to Teesside. We're transporting the ore. Another benefit of polyhalite, it's being ability to use slurry transport. So transport.
That'd be by road?
No, buried pipeline. Right. Slurry pipeline. Right. So we just crush and grind it at the mine, and then in a buried pipeline, take it to Teesside. Mm. Much like iron ore and coal all over the world. And that leaves a very, very small footprint. And then all of our buildings we're recessing into the ground so that the visual impact on what is a place of outstanding natural beauty. I now live there, and I can vouch for how nice it is.
Right.
We won't have much of a visual impact at all.
Okay. You mentioned value creation in terms of the taxpayer. What about for the investor? What milestones should we be watching out for? What are the big events that are going to happen that's going to start to create value?
I think the feasibility studies, where you take what was a scoping study, which was a plus or minus 35% conceptual look at what the project could do, and then you take it into a pre-feasibility, then feasibility, where you crystallise those costs and you also work out define delivery timeframes, get contractors on the hook in terms of delivering key components. Those will start coming out towards the end of this year. We've said that the pre-feasibility study will be out in November, and we're working very hard to achieve that. I think the application for the National Park, where the project is fully defined as it needs to be at that point, which we're targeting in early December, that'll be another critical milestone. And then obviously from there, full feasibility study, and then the approval by March. The common view that we get from people engaging around investors is the planning approval is one where people sit there and generally their reaction is, ooh, National Park. But when you have a look at how we're doing it, the support we have in the community, the understanding of the project, I think people are getting more and more comfort now, particularly now that we have the designs of what the mine looks like. It gives people something far more real than just, we need potash, we need jobs, but what's the cost? And now in terms of visual and impact, they can see that. That makes a big step forward.
Briefly, what about the share price? I know you've got other assets. What is priced into the share at these levels?
In the scoping study, we announced a view of what's potential value. So we announced the net present value of what the project would be, and that would be the equivalent of essentially the value of the project that you started construction, and that was around $6 billion US. On the day that you start production 3 years later, it's around $11 billion of net present value on that day. So the value of the deposit is significant. So the share price today, where we're around 18 or 19p today, is a fair way short of that. But that's things like people's perceptions of risk of approval, risk of financing, and then just general macroeconomic risk. I think right now the investors generally around the world are still a little risk off in their attitude to development companies. But we've got a tremendous team of people, of operators and constructors now, who can deliver this project in the right way and in record time. And that will very quickly move through that curve to that point of getting under construction underway.
And other interests?
The other interests, Sirius is committed to being a major player in potash and in minerals for fertilisers. Obviously, polyhalite is unique in that it has four of the macronutrients for food production. So we're already a multi-nutrient company, but potash is really at the core of it all. The other assets we have are earlier stage potash exploration plays in North Dakota, Queensland and Western Australia. And we continue to review other opportunities. We are looking in other basins around the world, but we're genuinely struggling to find anything that has the quality of what we have in York.
Yeah.
So the other assets are very much on the back burner at the moment until we've moved this asset forward.
Okay, Chris, it's a pleasure. Thanks for joining us. Chris Fraser, Chief Executive of Sirius Minerals.